Other popular theories that consider the family as a factor in delinquency include birth order, which proposes that middle-aged children are more likely to be delinquent. This theory proposes that the older child would get the parents' undivided attention and affection, and that the last child benefits from the experience the parents have had and gets more attention as the baby in the family, while the middle child gets lost. Large families, too, may increase the likelihood of delinquency. The research has shown that larger families are more prone to delinquent children, and researchers have hypothesized that delinquency is learned from the other family members, and that there's a greater likelihood there will be a delinquent sibling in a larger family. Delinquent siblings or criminal parents is a factor as well, and again, this is due to the learned behavior from observing delinquent or criminal activities by other family members. Studies have shown that poor quality of home life, which is measured by marital adjustment and harmony within the home, affects the rate of delinquent behavior among children more than whether the family is intact. One researcher, Nye, found that the happiness of the marriage was the main factor in predicting whether children become delinquent or not. At the same time, research has shown that rejection by parents is a significant factor as to whether a child becomes delinquent. Inadequate discipline or supervision in the home is a factor as well. And some researchers have studied what they call parent efficacy, meaning how the parents monitor, how they guide, and how they control the child's activities and behaviors, combined with the amounts and types of parental support. So this kind of study looks at the relationship with the parents, as well as how the child is disciplined or supervised. Considering all these factors, it becomes clear that the major premise of this course, that no one theory can explain all delinquent behaviors, is at play here. There are numerous conflicting findings, so that it becomes impossible to draw just one conclusion about the relationships between delinquency and the family. But at the same time, we can draw some very general conclusions. First, the obvious is that delinquency is a complex phenomenon. Second, that poverty does appear to be a factor in how the youth is treated by the juvenile justice system, in that children that are in poverty are more likely to receive services and then ultimately become committed to the state. And that family problems definitely place the child at higher risk to become delinquent. In considering the resources that affect the likelihood of delinquency, we need to be aware of the number and percentage of children that live in either poverty or extreme poverty. 2/3 of all those that are in poverty are children. We think of poverty as affecting adults, but disproportionately it affects children. This chart illustrates the percentage of American children by income. Economic hardship and lack of access to opportunity tend to undermine marital and parental functioning as well. Neglect and child abuse have a profound effect on the child, too. These events can influence behaviors and attitudes of children, adolescents, and carry over into adulthood. There are various categories of child abuse and neglect: physical abuse, sexual abuse, physical neglect, lack of supervision, or moral neglect, emotional maltreatment, educational maltreatment, and moral or legal maltreatment. These different categories comprise collectively what is known as child maltreatment. What I want to call attention to also is what's known as benign neglect and educational neglect. These are not always as easy to see or understand as physical neglect, harm, or even emotional trauma. Benign neglect is when the parent cares about the child but does not provide for their day-to-day emotional needs. It's not as obvious as neglecting to feed a child or get the child medical care or even supervise the child, but it can have a negative effect on the child all the same. And educational neglect means not providing for the educational needs of the child. Usually it's associated with truancy cases. So if a parent willingly allows the child to stay home from school when that child does not want to go, the parent can be charged with educational neglect. Being abused or neglected as a child increases the likelihood of arrest as a juvenile by 59% and as an adult by 29%, and for violent crime by 30%. Children that are maltreated tend to be younger at the first time of arrest, committed nearly twice as many offenses, and were arrested more frequently. Physically abused and neglected children versus sexually abused are the most likely to get arrested later in life for a violent crime. Abused and neglected white children are no more likely to get arrested for a violent crime than their non-abused and non-neglected white counterparts. But abused and neglected African American children show significantly increased rates of violent arrests compared with African American children who are not maltreated. And that's from Whittem and Maxfield in 2001. When there are suspicions of child abuse, then Child Protective Services are supposed to get involved. Now, there are theories about violent video games, and that the violence presented in the mass media has been a popular theory of causation in the past couple of decades. The mass media has tremendous influence on children. And when I refer to mass media, I'm talking about the internet, radio, television, commercial motion pictures, videos, CDs, music, and the press. Many people watch a large amount of television, and in some ways it can be thought of as one of the most powerful socializing agents today. Many people depend on media programming to understand the world in which we live. Researchers who have studied television's effect on children tend to conclude that television violence is most likely to affect those children that are already predisposed to violence. It seems to have much less influence on those that are not so predisposed. Video games, such as Halo 2 and Grand Theft Auto, are the focus of considerable controversy today. Some people accuse video game makers of promoting values that support violence. The software and entertainment industry makes about $28 billion a year and defends their products, stating they are offered only for entertainment purposes. In a study that looked at boys ages 12 to 14, Olson and Warner concluded that boys used video games to fantasize about power and fame, to work through their angry feelings or to relieve stress, and to explore and master what they perceived to be exciting and realistic environments. The boys in the study did not think that watching the violent video games affected them negatively, but they were worried that younger children might imitate the game behavior, particularly the swearing. The internet also has an effect on crime, particularly in the area of hate groups. Youthful perpetrators of violent crimes are sometimes influenced by information collected or contacts that are made on the internet. Child sexual abuse is often made through initial contacts made on the web. Sexual abuse, where the victim meets the perpetrator on the internet, now accounts for up to 4% of all arrests for sexual assaults against minors. And some believe that gangster rap negatively influences young people by devaluing human life, the family, religious institutions, schools, and the justice system. Guns play a prominent part in these lyrics and are frequently depicted as a means for attaining manhood and status.